I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted your name and your word above everything. On the day I called you, you answered me. You increased the strength of my soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. They shall sing the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. Let us worship God. Pressure to conform to this world, to capitulate to earthly powers rather than fear the Lord, tempts us, and sometimes we give in to that. We give in to that temptation. We confess Jesus is Lord with our lips, but our actions reveal that our loyalty lies elsewhere. Nonetheless, God is merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. With the confidence of the children of God, we join together and confess our sin. May we bow in prayerful silence and confess our sin to the Lord. We can trust that when we call out to God, God hears and responds. When we humble ourselves and honestly confess, God forgives and makes us new creations. Friends, believe the good news that through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning. I've got Reese here, and we have a friend that's going to help us talk about our children's message for this week. So everybody knows what these are. This is an egg, but what we're going to talk about this week is pressure and what you do with it. Did you know that you can hold an egg in your hand, and no matter how much pressure you apply to it, nothing's going to happen to it. So Reese is squeezing this egg. We hope it doesn't end up all over the church floor. But did you know if you apply pressure to an egg, the way that it's built, nothing's going to happen to it. Now, if you crack it on the edge of a bowl or if something comes at it from the side, then yes, you know, we crack eggs for recipes and things. But if you take an egg and squeeze it like that in your hand, nothing happens to it. So this week we're going to talk about the Bible verse that tells us that we're fearfully and wonderfully made. So the egg is made just the way that God wanted to make the egg, and we're made just the way that God wanted to make us. And I thought that was really neat. So we're made that way, and we have lots of things that go on in our life. So let's talk about the pressure. This week, I was listening to a song that I like to listen to. It's by Elevation Worship, and it's O Come to the Altar. And there's a line in the song that says, bear your cross while you wait for the crown. And so I thought about the egg, and I thought about the pressure, and I thought about the line in that song. And how are we bearing our pressure? How are we bearing our cross while we wait until we're in heaven with Jesus one day? So the pressures that life throws at us, we're already built for that because we're fearfully and wonderfully made. Whatever life throws at us, God's already self-built us for that. We have our shell just like the egg does. And how awesome is that, that our God takes care of us and gives us everything that we need. So there are lots of things going on in the world. We're getting ready to go back to school. COVID still hasn't gone anywhere. There are lots of uncertainties, but we know that whatever is thrown at us in life, that we have a shell, that God made us just the way that we're supposed to be. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. And I think that's something that we can pray about. We come to you this week, God, asking you for your assurance. Sometimes it's not easy for us to remember that we have a shell, that we're made absolutely perfect in the way that you want us to be. Help us to remember that as we go out into the world, and help us to bear our cross and always show your light everywhere we go in the world. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
We're going again.
Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah. And still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets," he said to them. "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever on earth bind, you will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing lower, some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, applause, or anything they got. Now, all God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, applause, or anything they got. Now,
listen to the top where the little bird sings, and the melodies and the high notes ringing, and the hood owl cries over everything, and the blackbird disagrees.
Singing in the nighttime, singing in the day, and the little duck quacks and he's on his way, and the otter hasn't got much to say, and the porcupine talks to himself.
All the creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, applause, or anything they got now.
And the cats, they tick up the middle, where the honeybee hums and the cricket fiddles, the donkey brays and the pony neighs, the old great badger sighs.
Listen through the bass is the one on the bottom where the bullfrog croaks and the hippopotamus moans and groans with the big to-do, and the old cow just goes moo.
All those creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands and balls or anything they got now. It's a simple song, a little song everywhere, by the ox and the fox and the grizzly bear, the dopey alligator and the hawk above, the sly old weasel and the turtle dove. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, applause, or anything they got. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, applause, or anything they got. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, applause, or anything they got now. All God's creatures got a place in the choir.
Have you ever had one of those aha moments where the light comes on and it's one of those oh yeah moments? I really enjoy those, especially at my age, when I remember why I went into the kitchen. Oh yeah, the paper towel. Or to the bedroom. Oh yeah, my reading glasses. Or to the grocery store. Oh yeah, the green beans. The gospel lesson this morning takes us to a private dialogue taking place between Jesus and his disciples. His popularity has certainly grown in this time of his earthly ministry, and the crowds gather when they hear his coming into their villages and regions. His miracles have revealed his authority and power. He's fed 5,000 with 5 loaves, 4,000 with 7, with many basketfuls left over. He's been confronted time and time again by the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and that's just a handful of personal experiences witnessed by his disciples. So now they have crossed the Sea of Galilee, and they're in Caesarea Philippi, north of Galilee, which today would be Lebanon, on a retreat in isolation in a somewhat alien location, in private conversation. And Jesus asks, "You fellas, you've been milling around the people. What do you hear them saying about me? Who do they say I am?" Well, there doesn't seem to be a lot of eagerness to respond. And they say, "Well, some say you're John the Baptist. Some say you're Elijah. Some Jeremiah and one of the prophets." And then comes the inside out question. Simple, but yet profound. He asks, "But what about you? Who do you say I am?" And Simon Peter spoke in a confident voice, "You are the Messiah, the Christ, Christos, the Son of the living God." Did you notice the response in the gospel reading that Reese read earlier, that Jesus' response was swift? He praised Simon for his insight. "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. You have not gained this insight through human process. You know this because my Father in heaven revealed it to you. Blessed are you, Simon, for what you represent, you are a man of stone. It is upon your confession that I will build my church, my vehicle for carrying the gospel message to the world, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." Peter spoke his faith from his heart. He gave a good confession of his confidence that Jesus Christ was the way, the truth, and the life. And the reality, my friends, we are called to do the very same. And when we do, people have a right to look at us and make a decision about the value of Christianity by what they see in our lives. You know, we may be the only sermon some people will ever hear. But please remember, we don't have all the answers, and we don't have to have all the answers. We only need to be open and honest as we struggle to address the challenges of today with a faith that has been marinating for over 2,000 years. So the question is at hand, but who do you say I am? That's a question I can't answer for you. I don't intend to. I just can't. Each of us must answer that question for ourselves. And it's not a test or a quiz. If anything, it's an examination of our own lives. And I really don't think Jesus is asking us to piggyback on the answers that we've heard or read, be them from a priest, a preacher, a teacher, parents, friends, prayer groups, Sunday school lessons, or bumper stickers. Maybe that's why he pushes his disciples to move from what they are hearing around them, John, Elijah, Jeremiah, one of the prophets, to what they are hearing within them. It's not an easy question. I wonder sometimes if we're too readily to accept and settle for the Sunday school answers, you know, the easy, feel-good, sentimental ones. The problem is, life isn't always easy, feel-good, nor sentimental. It's one thing to say who Jesus is during our virtual worship service this morning, while sitting there on the couch, maybe on the den, maybe on the back porch, enjoying a cup of coffee. It's a very different thing to say who Jesus is outside in that setting in the world, in the context of everyday life and everyday living. So let me put it to you the way I put it to me. Who do we say Jesus is as we deal with the rampage of this pandemic? Who do we say Jesus is when there are people in our town who go to bed hungry, who live in the midst of domestic violence? Who do we say Jesus is when people in town work for a wage that won't support their family? Who do we say Jesus is as racial tensions increase across our country? When a loved one dies, when a doctor gives the news we don't want to hear, and life seems to be falling apart? Who do we say Jesus is when we're forced to make decisions that have no easy answers, and the night is dark, sleepless, and the storms of life overwhelm us? Using the context of those few examples, what does it mean to say Jesus is my personal Lord, Savior, my example, my brother and friend? What does it mean to say Jesus is my life, the song I sing, my teacher? Here's my point. Who we say Jesus is has everything to do with who and how we are and will be. In some ways, our answer says as much about us as it does Jesus. It reveals how we live and what we stand for. It guides our decisions and determines our actions, how we speak, how we treat others. It describes the expectations and demands we place on Jesus. It discloses the depths of our motivation and commitment to following Him, a motivation and a commitment that will be challenged by next week's gospel lesson when Jesus instructs us to take up our cross and die with Him. The question isn't so much about getting the right answer as it is about witnessing and testifying to God's life, love, presence, and grace in our lives and in this world. It is less about our intellect and more about our heart. It is grounded in a love and grace that far surpasses our understanding. And if anything, it is to move us from simply knowing about Jesus to knowing Him. There was another time when Jesus was in a dialogue with His disciples. John's gospel captures that moment when many seemed to be forsaking Jesus. Jesus turned to the 12 and in a private moment asked, "Do you also wish to go away?" Once again, Peter speaks from the heart in words that capture faith. "Lord," he asks, "to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." My friends, may our loving and gracious God give us the faith and stamina to live as His sons and daughters now and always. And may we, as His sons and daughters and brothers and sisters of Christ, pray continually for Christ awareness in our lives. And we, His church, proclaim the gospel message to all. Aha! For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Amen. Amen.